Phoenix Lucille Reeves was born in California on May 23, 1988 to Goldia, a single mother. When Goldia married Lawrence Coldon, a computer systems expert, he took Phoenix in as his own and ultimately adopted her. Phoenix's surname was changed to Coldon when the family relocated to Missouri. The family of three settled in the Spanish Lake neighborhood. Their Countrybrook Drive house was serene and tranquil. Goldia Lawrence, a social worker, was a devout Christian who instilled Christian ideals in her daughter. They attended church together and prayed at home together. Phoenix always performed well in school and was well liked by her classmates and church members. Phoenix was well liked by everyone who met her. She was kind and courteous. Although she was quiet, she had a wicked sense of humor and a passion for athletics. Her parents aided and assisted their talented daughter in every way imaginable, ensuring she got the finest chances available. When Goldia was in the sixth grade, she left her job and began homeschooling Phoenix. Phoenix's friends said that she would have liked to spend her senior year of high school among her classmates. Phoenix spent the most of her afternoons waiting at the bus stop for her neighborhood mates to return from school. Goldia was always on the lookout for Phoenix's pals, since she did not want her daughter to get involved with the wrong set. Phoenix excelled academically and aspired to be a doctor. She had a high musical aptitude and possessed the ability to play the guitar and the piano. She also got violin lessons from a church buddy who was the orchestra's second seat. When she wasn't making music, Phoenix enjoyed playing basketball and spent a lot of time watching games and shooting hoops with her male cousins. However, fencing was her preferred sport. Years of hard work paid off when she won the junior championship in a local tournament. Phoenix looked forward to a bright future. However, as a homeschooled child, she was sheltered and very much under her parents' control. Goldia was adamant about the proper behavior of a young Christian lady. Phoenix, for the most part, appeared to agree with her mother. They never had a real argument, and she never acted out. She was deeply religious in her own right and adhered to her parents' teachings. Phoenix moved into an apartment with a friend in 2007 after earning her high school diploma. The lease was signed by Goldia. Phoenix maintained regular contact with her parents during this time period and continued to attend church with them on Sundays. After 4 years, Goldia felt that covering Phoenix's rent was an unnecessary expense. She was a student at the University of Missouri in St. Louis, so it was natural for her to live at home. Phoenix returned home in May 2011 after living independently for 4 years. However, things were not as they were when Phoenix was a teenager. She was constantly at odds with her parents over everything and anything. Phoenix spent hours in her driveway, sitting in her car and talking on the phone with friends. Goldia thought it was odd but was unconcerned. She believed her daughter required privacy only upon her return to the family home, and thus avoided inquiring about it. Phoenix, 23, attended the Sunday morning church service at 11 a.m. 1 week before Christmas in 2011. She sang in the handbell choir and waited in her truck while her mother attended the weekly fellowship gathering. She pleaded with her mother not to linger too long. They stopped at a convenience store on their way home. Phoenix confided in her mother during the drive and expressed her desire for things to return to the way they were. She was done fighting. Goldia expressed gratitude to the Lord and expressed joy that her daughter desired emotional reconciliation with her. They had been home for a short time when Phoenix took her phone, walked silently past her father and out the front door. Lawrence observed her entering her black 1998 Chevrolet Blazer and conversing on the phone. Her outfit consisted of a dark hoodie, gray Lindenwood sweatpants, and black sneakers. Around 2:20 p.m., Lawrence noticed Phoenix's car exiting the drive. He assumed she was on her way to the store or to see a friend. Lawrence never saw his daughter again after this. Goldia was concerned when Phoenix failed to return home that evening, but Lawrence reassured her that everything would be fine. By 12 a.m., Goldia was convinced Phoenix was in danger, but she was unable to contact her via her cell phone. Phoenix would never stay out until that hour without informing them of her whereabouts. There was little else they could do but wait and pray for her return. It had been a long, anxious, sleepless night. Phoenix, even as a 23-year-old, followed the rules of her family home, including Goldia's 1 a.m. curfew. She had never returned later than 1:20 a.m. By the time morning arrived, there was still no sign of Phoenix. She had never before stayed out all night. Goldia and Lawrence contacted all of her friends to inquire about her whereabouts. Nobody had seen her or had any idea what she had done the day before. The Coldons then contacted hospitals, but found that no one fitting Phoenix's description had been admitted the previous night. Goldia and Lawrence went to the police and reported Phoenix missing, but because she was an adult who had not been missing for more than 24 hours, there was little police could do. The duty officer searched for the license plate number of the Chevy Blazer, but there was no record of the vehicle being involved in an accident. In fact, the car had been impounded the day before. Typically, information about all impounded vehicles is entered into a central database, but due to a system delay, it did not appear in the search. Phoenix's family was distraught and took to the streets, aided by friends and members of the church community. Everyone was on the lookout for Phoenix. Christmas came and went, and the presents under the tree remained unopened. Phoenix was away from home for the first time in his life during the holidays. For the Coldon family, this was always a special time, a religious celebration. Goldia and Lauren spent their vacations handing out flyers and visiting all of Phoenix's well-known restaurants and stores. They contacted everyone they knew who was familiar with Phoenix, but no one had any information. It was as if she had been swallowed whole by the earth. Goldia received a phone call early in the new year from a family friend. The man was stunned when he inquired about Phoenix's disappearance. He called back 10 minutes later to report that he had located Phoenix's car, which had been sitting in a tow yard in East St. Louis since the day she vanished. What they discovered was that at 5:27 p.m. on the day Phoenix vanished, her car was discovered abandoned in East St. Louis, Illinois, at the intersection of 9th Street and St. Clair Avenue. The car was parked in the middle of the road, the ignition still turned on and the driver's door ajar. At the time, police were unable to locate the car's owner and ordered the vehicle towed due to its obstructive nature. The car was abandoned in a dangerous part of town, and the immediate assumption was that it had been stolen or that the driver had committed a crime. At 6:23 p.m., the vehicle was towed to the yard after Officer Perry confirmed that it was not stolen. Despite the fact that the vehicle was registered to Goldia Coldon and contained all necessary documentation in the glove compartment, police never informed the Coldons that they were in possession of the blazer. The negligence of law enforcement at the abandoned car scene, and administrative blunders, have caused an uproar of criticism from the community. The family even had to apply directly to the mayor to have the impound fee of $1,000 waived. When Lawrence and Goldia learned that Phoenix's car had been discovered in East St. Louis, they were dumbfounded. They had no idea why she would have gone into such a dangerous neighborhood. East St. Louis was only a 30-minute drive away from her home, but it was a world away from her safe suburban life. Police searched the area where the car was found, they even brought in cadaver dogs, but neither Phoenix nor any of her belongings could be found. After she disappeared, there was no sign of her on social media, no calls were made on her cell phone, and she had not accessed her banking account. Police processed her SUV, but could not find any evidence indicating foul play. The only DNA inside the car belonged to Phoenix, her mom and her dad. Inside the vehicle, they found her ID, purse and eyeglasses and shoes. There was also half a can of soda and a plastic bag with slices of lemon, something Phoenix loved to snack on. Goldia said that it didn't come from their home and it wasn't in the car earlier that day when they went to church. Did Phoenix go to someone's home, someone who knew her well enough to have given her a bag of sliced lemons? And where did she get the soda from? The time between Phoenix leaving home and her car being found was between 2 and 3 hours. If they could find out more about her movements, it could break the case wide open. A peculiar clue found in the car was a handwritten note that had been torn up, with some pieces missing. At first, Goldia and Lawrence did not think the handwriting was Phoenix's. However, given that it was their sole hint, Goldia did not leave it at that. She combed through Phoenix's home journals and examined her notes with a magnifying lens. She discovered some scribblings that seemed to have been written by Phoenix in a hurry, and they were almost similar to the writing on the letter discovered in the vehicle. The letter was dated December 18, 2011, the same day of her disappearance. Although portions of the letter were missing, Goldia said that what they could make out was a cryptic message that read, "We believe you should make up your mind before 2012, or else I shall demonstrate what I am capable of doing with regards to your parents." It makes little sense, but Goldia took it to be a recounting of a discussion Phoenix had with someone who threatened her. Goldia surmised that Phoenix penned the letter as she waited for her outside the church where Goldia attended fellowship. She had the impression that Phoenix had placed the letter in the glove box for them to discover in case anything happened to her. It was a hint, but what it signified and who threatened her remained a mystery. Goldia informed a local newspaper in March 2012 that they had gotten a fresh lead. According to a witness, when Phoenix's vehicle was parked in her driveway, a green sedan was parked behind it. Phoenix's vehicle was being driven by a black guy with dreadlocks and a skull hat. On online forums, there has been discussion about this claim, although it has not been verified. Apart from this article, Phoenix's situation got little public attention. Her tale was hardly mentioned in the press. As Goldia put it, "The news media would not give us a chance. If Phoenix resembled Natalie Holloway, we would not have encountered this issue." Phoenix was last seen a few months ago, and authorities had no idea what could have happened to her. Lawrence and Goldia were dissatisfied with the police and decided to employ private investigator Steve Foster. However, they also went out on their own, searching the streets of East St. Louis for her. Goldia and Lawrence started to discover a new side to their gorgeous, bright-eyed, God-fearing daughter during their desperate quest. They discovered that Phoenix had never shared an apartment with another girl. She shared an apartment with her lover, Mike. Her parents were unaware she was seeing someone, much less living with him, in the flat for which Goldia had signed the lease. Goldia said that she had visited Phoenix's apartment and examined the closet and medicine cabinet. She discovered no evidence of a guy living with her. She felt the need to check on her adult daughter, which was unusual, but that was the way things were. Phoenix's parents understood why she lied about having a partner in retrospect, since her Christian upbringing emphasized the need of saving oneself for marriage. Lawrence and Goldia would have objected to her cohabiting with a guy. And even if they had accepted her relationship status, Mike was almost certainly not the kind of guy they would have approved of. When the Coldons learned about Mike, they attempted to contact him, but he refused to answer their questions regarding their daughter's abduction. Because Phoenix had never disclosed the connection to her parents, Goldia was unsure if Phoenix was still seeing him when she vanished. Phoenix's relationship with Mike had lasted 2 to 3 years and she had even lived with him was a lot to comprehend. They realized it was a major connection when they looked through Phoenix's things. She had attended family gatherings with him and was ingrained in his life. Nonetheless, Mike and his parents maintained that they were unfamiliar with Phoenix and requested that the Coldons refrain from pestering them with inquiries. Perhaps they suspected the Coldons of something, but they were just befuddled parents trying to locate their daughter. The Coldons were certain Mike had nothing to do with their daughter's disappearance but questioned whether he had exposed her to a world populated with unsavory people. In an Oxygen documentary, journalist Shan Maria Thomas collaborated with former police chief Joe Delia to re-examine the Phoenix Coldon case. They conducted re-interviews with key participants in the case. Officer Benjamin Granda of the St. Louis County Police Department said in an interview that Phoenix's live-in boyfriend, Mike, was very cooperative throughout the investigation's early phases. He was quickly thrown out of the investigation as a suspect. He also took and passed a lie detector exam. Officer Perry, who was sent to the abandoned vehicle scene, was also interviewed for the Oxygen program. He amended his original testimony, stating that the car's ignition was turned off and the driver's door was not open at the time. He thought it was a vehicle running out of petrol. Because nothing in the vehicle suggested that it had been used to conduct a crime, he did not consider it suspicious. It is unknown why he altered his remark. Lawrence and Goldia continued their own investigations as well. They made a visit to Phoenix's alma mater, the University of Missouri in St. Louis. They were taken aback when they discovered she had not registered for any autumn semester courses. This was completely out of character for Phoenix, who had always been very proud of her academic accomplishments. Investigators unearthed more secrets. Phoenix also had a second phone, which came with a hefty cost. Tim Baker, one of her closest friends, was aware she had two phones, one on her family plan and another in her own name. She incorporated both. He believed the second phone was used to contact Mike, since her parents were unaware of his existence. Billing on an itemized basis would have revealed their connection. However, after returning home, phone bills revealed that she sometimes used the family plan phone to contact Mike. Perhaps she hoped to bring the connection to light. She had a nearly two-hour chat with Mike the day before she was last seen, according to phone records. Mike first denied speaking with Phoenix, but when confronted with phone records, he was forced to acknowledge they spoke. When asked what they talked, he said he couldn't recall. He called her at 9:41 a.m. on the day Phoenix vanished, and they talked for 6 minutes. Phoenix's family plan phone's last call was a one-minute call to Mike at 1:46 p.m. She was gone an hour later. After she disappeared, that phone stopped receiving incoming calls. Which raises the question, were her pals all aware of something? Was she intending to depart? The Coldons talked with many of Phoenix's acquaintances and discovered that she had dabbled with narcotics. Phoenix's acquaintances hinted to the fact that she was connected with several men in the months before her disappearance. Investigators were unable to talk with many of Phoenix's pals. This just added to the mystique surrounding her disappearance, but also her existence. Phoenix's parents were disturbed to discover that she had a second life. Her pals were not searching for her. What significance did these friendships have? They did not seem to be very worried about her disappearance. Perhaps they knew more than they disclosed? What transpired? What was the identity of Phoenix Coldon? And was she really unknown? That was irrelevant. They were anxious to locate her and return her to the protection of their family home. They reasoned that her closest friend, Akira Hogan, who lived only a few homes down the road, would be aware of what was happening in Phoenix's life. However, Akira was unwilling to speak. According to the Coldons, Akira never even paid them a visit after Phoenix's disappearance. She never provided assistance or anything else. Their sole interaction was when Akira's family informed the Coldons that police had interrogated Akira at work and they were not pleased. Chandria Thomas and Joe Delia were able to speak with Akira, Phoenix's closest buddy. Phoenix's parents, she said, were very controlling over every area of her life. Things got tense when Phoenix moved back home with her parents. Phoenix was irritable and often quarreled with her parents. Akira was able to ascertain why Phoenix had a second phone, to communicate with another lover, also called Mike, whom she was dating in 2010. Phoenix met the second Mike when he was working at a department shop. He offered her complimentary samples of cosmetic items, and the harmless flirting quickly developed into a relationship. Phoenix would have liked to hide this from her live-in lover, Mike. Additionally, given that her parents were unaware of her main lover, she would have wanted to keep the illicit connection hidden from them. Akira was unaware if her connection with the second Mike lasted when she returned to live with her parents. Akira also stated that Phoenix developed paranoia in the months before her abduction. She had the distinct impression that she was being pursued by someone or something. All of this became too weird for Akira, and she began to withdraw from Phoenix. Akira last talked to her buddy a week before she vanished, after a heated altercation. Phoenix then drew a knife from his pocket. Akira called her bluff. She was unfazed, knowing Phoenix would never hurt her. Phoenix, according to Akira, was not herself and said that she intended to collect her belongings and go. Joe Delia and Chandria Thomas discovered that the second Mike was the subject of a restraining order issued by an ex-girlfriend. Additionally, she said that in December 2011, he compulsively studied Phoenix Coldon's case. When his fiancée confronted him, he confessed to have had intercourse relations with Phoenix. When his partner expressed jealousy, he inquired as to why she was concerned about someone who had died. The girlfriend wasn't sure whether he said it because he thought Phoenix had died or if there was another, more nefarious reason. Perhaps the most important finding, as revealed in Chandria Thomas' documentary, was a selfie video shot by Phoenix on November 15, 2011, less than a month before she vanished. Phoenix, upset, sits behind the wheel of her vehicle and addresses the camera. Here are some excerpts from her remarks. "I was dumped. This is absurd. I just want to restart. I just feel as if I am unable to restart the new self. The public does not give a f and. I'm not sure, I've got to view things for what they are, rather than thinking about them that way. Consider things in their whole." Then she silently recites a condensed version of the Serenity Prayer that is meaningful to her personally. "Please, Lord, assist me in accepting the things that cannot be changed. And that I will not alter what I am unable to change." Phoenix mumbles often during the video, tears welling up in her large brown eyes. She sometimes glances over her shoulder, as if she's afraid someone may see her. "That is why I am averse to social interaction. When I'm angry or anything, and I say things I don't intend, that's when you learn to hold. Maintain your composure. I'm hoping that people will take me seriously. I just want happiness, dude. I can't recall a moment when I was content. Genuinely content. I feel so foolish because I allowed myself to be a little careless. I'm sure I would have been in a better position if I had stayed with the way things used to be. Perhaps it's better to travel in the rear with all the police crammed in here. The one person who will never fail me, is myself." Joe Delia deduced from this that Phoenix was a disturbed young lady. The inference is clear that she had done something for which she was embarrassed, something that was inconsistent with how things used to be. Is it possible that Phoenix got caught up with the wrong people? Was she in any kind of predicament? Phoenix, the Coldons surmised, had gone that day to meet someone she knew. They suspect she traveled to East St. Louis for no reason, rather, they believe she drove away with the intention of returning. Additionally, they are certain that Phoenix did not leave the vehicle at the location where it was discovered. They believe that someone else, possibly an abduction, drove there knowing that an abandoned vehicle would not attract much notice on East St. Louis crime-ridden streets. One aspect that had always vexed Goldia was the fact that a family acquaintance had discovered Phoenix's vehicle. She'd sent an email to all their connections in the days after Phoenix's disappearance, and this friend was included in the list of recipients. Yet when he phoned 2 weeks later, he pretended to be unaware. If the police were unable to locate Phoenix's Chevrolet Blazer during that time period, how was this guy able to do it in a matter of minutes? Perhaps he was aware of Phoenix's fate? The guy said he didn't, but he couldn't explain how he knew the location of her vehicle. According to Goldia, when your daughter goes missing, you lose faith in everything. She couldn't afford to be completely focused on this guy and ignore other options. The Coldons discovered a whole new realm during their search, that of intercourse trafficking. The morally upright parents ended themselves at strip clubs, where they interacted with everyone from intercourse workers to bartenders and drug dealers. Goldia and Lawrence learned that another young lady had been abducted from her vehicle near the location of Phoenix's Chevy Blazer. The victim said that she was abducted from her vehicle as she came to a stop at a traffic signal. Her kidnappers left her car running while they drove her to a neighboring residence. According to the lady, she was informed that she would be hired as a prostitute by them. Fortunately, she was able to flee. Phoenix's vehicle was discovered in an area of East St. Louis previously associated with human trafficking. Interstate 70, which runs beside East St. Louis, is a well-known trafficking route. Indeed, a statement released by the Missouri Sheriff's Association. The St. Louis metropolitan area is one of the top 20 hotspots for human trafficking in the country. Although the prospect of intercourse trafficking occurring in suburban America is disturbing, it is a reality. According to data on the Human Trafficking Hotline's website, over 8,000 instances of intercourse trafficking were recorded in 2019. Phoenix's selfie video does seem to indicate that she was groomed by intercourse traffickers. Chandria Thomas and Joe Delia talked with Katie Riodes, founder of Healing Action, an organization dedicated to assisting survivors of indecent exploitation. Katie showed how human traffickers operate. They often target a vulnerable young woman who is unhappy with her situation. They make a promise to the girl that life would be better than it is now, dangling a carrot of what life might be like. They then stage an event to guarantee leverage over them, after a period of gradual grooming. It is a gradual grooming procedure followed by a fast grasp. Groomers operate in a variety of sectors and may be a friend or an imposter. In Phoenix's situation, proof of one heinous crime that would have horrified her parents would have been sufficient to persuade her to go. Perhaps she felt suffocated at home and fantasized of living alone, free of pressure and expectations. However, many who know Phoenix believe that even if she desired to go, she would never have been so callous as to leave her parents in the dark about her whereabouts. It is likely that, because to her lack of street smarts, someone gave her an escape route, which she accepted. However, after she departed, she became imprisoned and unable to return or contact her family. Steve Foster, the Coldon family's private investigator, uncovered a source of contention between Phoenix and her parents prior to her disappearance. She had redeemed savings bonds in her and her mother's names from the family safe. Phoenix amassed a total of $2,500. Nobody was aware of what she did with the funds. Was she attempting to establish a fund to assist her in escaping from home? Was she in debt to someone? Was she the victim of blackmail? In any case, Phoenix found two birth certificates while rooting around in the safe. One is Phoenix Reeves and another is Phoenix Coldon, which was issued when Lawrence adopted her. Could that have been the first time she discovered Lawrence was not her biological father? This also meant she discovered she was born out of wedlock, which was the polar opposite of what she had been told was correct. Goldia and Lawrence convinced her that intercourse should be reserved for reproduction, not pleasure, and that she should preserve herself for marriage, despite the fact that Goldia had Phoenix as a single mother. Nobody knows what was spoken in the household during this time period, but if this was all new to Phoenix, it would have caused her to doubt all she had ever learned. The refusal of many of her acquaintances to talk to authorities led investigators to think they knew something. They reasoned that she may have gone on her own and that her companions were covering for her. Joe Delia investigated the idea that Phoenix fled with the intention of starting anew. She may have obtained a social security number, driver's license, and passport using her original birth certificate as Phoenix Reeves. Joe's investigation discovered four individuals named Phoenix Reeves and was able to eliminate three. The fourth one grabbed their attention, since there was little public information available, other than an address in Alaska. Phoenix's name was associated with a residence in Anchorage in January 2012, only weeks after he was last seen in Missouri. Following June 2012, there is no record of the individual known as Phoenix Reeves. Joe Delia went to the location, but no one recognized Phoenix's photograph, and no one had ever heard of someone named Phoenix Reeves or Phoenix Coldon. It was a foregone conclusion. The absence of activity on her banking account and her lack of contact with anybody in her life indicate that Phoenix may have been the victim of foul play. Her disappearance has been connected to that of Stacy English, who disappeared in the same month and year as Phoenix. Stacy, 36, was last seen on Christmas morning and was reported missing on December 27. Her vehicle was discovered 20 miles from her residence. It was located on the road, and the ignition was running when it was discovered. Stacy's corpse was found a month later in a rural area approximately a mile from where her vehicle was abandoned. Although the cause of death was determined to be exposure, it seems improbable that Stacy would have left her car running, walked a mile, laid down beneath a tree, and succumbed to hypothermia. Phoenix's body has not been found, and police do not believe the cases are linked. Goldia and Lawrence Coldon stand firm in their belief that their daughter is still alive. They find it hard to imagine that she would have wanted to run away, but then again, there were so many things in Phoenix's life that she kept from them. Her family has launched a Facebook page with information about her disappearance. Over the years, they have received many false leads. There was even a hoax of a young woman pretending to be Phoenix. A man called from Texas and said that he knew where Phoenix was and that she had been taken into a prostitution ring. But later admitted that he had made it up in an attempt to get attention. The Coldon search effort has cost Lawrence and Goldia dearly, fees to private investigators, trips all over the country to follow up on leads, like the wild goose chase to Texas. Eventually, their family home was about to go into foreclosure. To which Goldia said, "Let them take the house. I don't care. All I want to know is where Phoenix is." Fortunately, they sold it in the nick of time and were able to relocate. Over the years, there have been a couple of sightings of Phoenix. 2.5 years after her disappearance, family friend, Jeffrey Hargrove, said he ran into Phoenix. He claims to have seen her in a grubby St. Louis grocery store, in broad daylight. He asked her if she was related to David Scott, who is Phoenix's uncle. Jeffrey said she didn't deny it, and it was clear she did not want to engage in conversation with him. He claims he saw her a week later around the same area. Jeffrey didn't approach her, because, in his opinion, she was a grown woman who left home and didn't want to be found. He did, however, inform her family. In 2014, Kelly Frunhert, a church friend of Phoenix's, also saw Phoenix on a flight from Las Vegas to St. Louis. She said that the woman whom she thought to be Phoenix was traveling with a couple of women and two men in their late 30s or early 40s. Kelly called out for Phoenix. The woman looked at her and said, "Oh, do I look like someone?" To which Kelly replied, "Yes, you do, you look like my friend Phoenix." The woman turned and walked away without saying anything else. Kelly was convinced that the woman was Phoenix. She informed cabin crew about her missing friend and Southwest Airlines contacted police. But once they reached the airport in St. Louis, the woman got lost in the crowd, and they could not find her. Phoenix's case has baffled her family, friends, and investigators for almost 10 years. What happened to her in that short, 2-hour, window of time, after leaving her home and abandoning her car? With absolutely no clues, and no one talking. Will they ever find out what happened to Phoenix?